occasion of the high-level workshop on Arab perspective on the future of UN peace and security, we have had the honor and the pleasure to welcome Ambassador El-Ghassim Wane, the Assistant UN Secretary General for Peacekeeping Operations, who has flew from New York for this event, and he will fly later tonight to join the Secretary General on his trip to Algeria, is it, and Mauritania, right? Mm. Welcome. I want to start first by a personal question. 21 years in the Peace and Security Department at the African Union, I guess the African Union has become home, and now you have been given this important and very challenging responsibility at the United Nations. Tell us about the move.
Well, the move is exciting. At the same time, difficult. Indeed, after 21 years at the African Union, one feels home, both at the EU and in Ethiopia. You make friends, good colleagues, work on exciting issues, and I work for the EU. Started working for the EU at a very exciting period. 6 years after I joined the EU, the organization transitioned to the African Union, and decided to have bigger ambitions and to adopt new institutions, new instruments to be able to meet the many challenges confronting the African continent, not only in the area of peace and security, but also in terms of economic integration and socio-economic development. And my 20 or two decades of work at the African Union have been particularly, say, exciting, rewarding. I did my best to make a modest contribution to what the organization has done. Moving to the UN, of course, is a new opportunity for me. First, to building on my experience at the African Union, it's an opportunity to work on not only on African issues, but also on other global issues, and Africa is part of the world. It's also an opportunity to contribute modestly to the enhancement of the partnership between the African Union and the United Nations.
Right, you take your office in the United Nations at a very exciting time. Mm-hmm. Last year saw three reviews, mm-hmm. One on peacekeeping, one on peace building, and the other on issues of women, peace, and security. And the intergovernmental debates about all of these reviews is already underway. There is this initiative by the President of the General Assembly, of which this workshop is part of, leading to the high-level thematic debate to take place in New York. Tell us about your first order of business. What do you think the UN should be involved with during the remaining period of the current Secretary General? What are the quick fixes? What are the low-hanging fruits? And also, what are the things that that are more strategic and needs a political investment and that should wait for the new Secretary General when he's appointed?
Well, I think that's a very difficult question, and I'm joining an organization, of course, that has set an agenda and is working on the basis of decisions taken by its relevant policy organs. My role in the Department of Peacekeeping Operation, being in charge of the Office of Operations, of course, is to ensure that the operations we do deploy on the ground are run as efficiently as possible, perform their mandates to the benefit of the country they are deployed in, mm-hmm. to the benefit of the people of those countries. And in that respect, of course, the first order of business for us, for me and my colleagues, is to provide the necessary support to our missions on the ground. As you know, United Nations missions, and not only United Nations, African Union and other missions, are increasingly deployed in a very difficult environment, and in such conditions, running a peacekeeping operation is not an easy task. And yet, we have to do our level best to meet the task at hand, to implement the mandate, to ensure that civilian populations are protected, to facilitate transition from a conflict situation or an immediate post-conflict situation to a more stable environment. And in doing so, we are guided by the decisions taken by the United Nations Security Council. So this is one of our first priorities. The second, of course, is to follow up on the various reviews you have referred to, and one of them relates to the United Nations peace operations. And as you are aware, following the HIPO report, the Secretary General issued his own report in response to the recommendations and orientations contained in the HIPO report, and they are extremely important. We did discuss them this morning, and they touch on a number of issues, of course, ranging from the importance of prevention, the primacy of politics, to enhancing the capabilities of the missions we deploy on the ground, and that follow-up requires sustained attention from the entire UN system, in particular from DPKO.
2016 is going to be a very significant year. It's the year where the international community selects the new Secretary General of the United Nations. But in the context of two files that you know like the back of your hand, the cooperation between the African Union and the United Nations, the developments that are taking place in this regard, it's the year where the African Union launches its new APSA roadmap, and it's also the last year of the implementation of the framework agreement between the United Nations and the African Union. Discussions are already undergoing to put together a new framework. What can you tell us about this?
Indeed, the partnership with the African Union and regional groupings in general is part and parcel of the United Nations priorities. And in actual fact, this is an issue that was highlighted in the HIPO report, which stressed the need for strong, closer, deeper cooperation between the United Nations and regional groupings if we are to address the challenges facing us, the very unstable environment in which peacekeeping operations are deployed, and the complexity of the conflicts facing today's world. And the African Union, in the context of the African continent, was identified as the strategic partner of the United Nations, together with its regional groupings. I should say that a lot has been achieved in ensuring that the partnership is focused, strong, and sustained. The two organizations convene regular consultations at various levels, secretariat level. They do also convene consultations at the level of their respective decision-making organs, the United Nations Security Council for the UN, the Peace and Security Council for the African Union. In addition, of course, the United Nations provides capacity building support to the AU in the context of the 10-year capacity building program. And I would say in many respects, it's an exemplary partnership. Mm. But of course, like any undertaking, there is room for improvement. Mm. And I believe the two organizations are committed to do what they can to improve and enhance that partnership, including on issues relating to funding, to consultations, on political issues of common interest, and more generally in ensuring that they closely coordinate their efforts when they are dealing with peace and security issues on the African continent. And have no doubt that the period ahead would see a further deepening of that cooperation.
One final question about another regional organization, the focus of our discussion today and tomorrow, and that is the League of Arab States. You describe the relationship between the UN and the AU as an exemplary. So how can we make use of that exemplary cooperation in laying down the foundations of cooperation between the UN on one hand and another regional organization, which is the League of Arab States?
Okay. Well, let me start by saying that the United Nations and the Arab League maintain a close working relationship. But of course, and that the intention of both organizations, there is need to enhance that relationship and partnership given the complexity of the issues facing the region. In that respect, learning or drawing lessons from the experience of the AU United Nations partnership could be extremely useful. We do all today welcome the strong partnership between the AU and the UN, but that partnership was a result of not only a strong political will from both organizations, but also hard work to put in place the basic requirements for a strong partnership. Mm-hmm. And I believe that a similar work is needed with respect to the relationship between the United Nations and the Arab League.
Starting with what?
Well, the political will is there. Now we have to build the requirements. Mm-hmm. And one of the requirements has to do with the need for the Arab League to build a minimum capacity so that it could more effectively partner with the United Nations. And that range, of course, from putting in place a comprehensive peace and security architecture, addressing issues related to funding, and looking at the best ways and means of addressing the conflicts facing the, or the peace and security challenges facing the Arab region.
That was Ambassador El-Ghassim Wane, Assistant UN Secretary General for Peacekeeping Operations, speaking to CCCPA on behalf of the high-level workshop on our perspective on the future of UN involvement in peace and security. Thank you, Ambassador Wane.
Thank you.